Hello students, in this video we look into one more solve problem on design of spur gauge, problem number 2. So let's get into the problem now. Okay, so this is the problem 2. Design a pair of spur gauge to transmit power of 18 kilowatt from a shaft running at 1000 rpm to a parallel shaft running at 250 rpm with a center distance of 160 millimeters. So there is very minimal data that is given in this problem, which would suggest that we will have to make a lot of assumptions as we go through the design process. Okay, so interesting things to note in this problem statement is that it's parallel shaft, hence we obviously use spur gauge. The power that needs to be transmitted is 18 kilowatt, and from a shaft running at 1000 rpm, that means that the pinion speed is 1000 rpm, to a parallel shaft running at 250 rpm, therefore the gear speed is 250 rpm, and the center distance is limited to 160 millimeters. All right, so that's the data that we have: power, NP, NG, and center distance A. All right, so let's go through the solution process now. In step number 1, since we do not know the diameters, the pitch circle diameters, nor the number of teeth, we will use the gear ratio and determine the pitch circle diameters first. Okay, now the speeds are known to us. Speed of pinion is 1000 and speed of gear is 250 rpm. Therefore, we obtain the gear ratio as 4, and using which to obtain the pitch circle diameters, we will get one equation as diameter of the gear is equal to 4 times diameter of the pinion. Therefore, that's the first equation, dg is equal to 4 times dp. Now we will find out diameters of gear and diameter of the pinion in the next slide. Okay, so let's move on. The center distance is 250 mm. Center distance, we know from the theory of gears that center distance will be average of the pitch circle diameters, which is equal to 160 mm as stated in the problem. Therefore, we end up with the second equation, dp plus dg is equal to 320. Therefore, we have equation number 1, which is dg is equal to 4 times dp, and then the second equation is this. Now, if you will substitute dg as equal to 4 times dp in equation number 2, we will end up with diameter, the pitch circle diameter of the pinion as 64 millimeters. Now, we know that diameter of the gear is 4 times diameter of the pinion, therefore it ends up being 256 millimeters. Alright, so with this we have obtained the pitch circle diameters. Okay. Now let's focus on the number of teeth. Now, in this problem, there is very minimal data that we have. Neither is the material of the gear and pinion specified, and neither is any information regarding the tooth form. Therefore, there is no way that we can calculate the number of teeth as of now. Therefore, what we do is, we will assume one of the parameters. Say we assume that the number of teeth in the pinion is equal to 20 mm. This is a random like assumption. And then, since we know that the gear ratio is 4, number of teeth on the gear will then be 4 times 20, which is equal to like 80 mm. Now, when I say that assumption of the number of teeth on the pinion is very random, there is a justification for that as well. In the sense, if you will open up table 12.4b in page number 230 of your handbook, you see that the smallest number of teeth that mesh with rack without like interference for a 20 degree full depth tooth form is 80. Okay, if our assumption of the number of teeth is more or less within the minimum number of tooth, sorry, minimum number of teeth requirement of 18. Okay, therefore, number of teeth on the pinion is an assumption that we make as equal to 20 mm. All right. So now that we know the number of teeth as well, we can go ahead and determine the Lewis form factor, which we need for further steps. Okay. Now, there is nothing specified regarding the tooth form. Therefore, we will assume 20 degree full depth tooth form. And from the design data handbook, equation number 12.5D, page number 204, we get the formula for Lewis form factor. And then substituting in that formula, we will get the tooth form factor for both pinion and gear as 0.1084 and 0.1426. Okay. Now, going forward, we need to know which is the weakest member, isn't it? If you have gone through the previous two solve problems, we know that we will have to identify the weaker member so that we can design for it. But here, we don't know the material now. Therefore, we don't know what allowable static stress to take into account. Therefore, we need to make the next assumption. Okay. Now, we begin with assuming that the pinion material has nickel chromium steel. Alright, now table 12.7 in page number 234 gives the list of materials that we use, that we normally use to manufacture gears. Right now, I have made an assumption that the pinion is nickel chromium steel. Now for nickel chromium steel, allowable static stress is 462 newton per millimeter square, which is available in table 12.7. Okay. Now that being the case, if I will multiply it with, now we know that the product of allowable static stress into tooth form, Lewis tooth form, has to be same for both. That's the theory of gears again. All right. Therefore, with that relation, I can now solve and obtain the static stress for the gear. And static stress for the gear falls to 351.2 newton per millimeter square. All right. Now, if I will go back to table 12.7 and check for which material has got a allowable static stress value of 351.2, I see that alloy steel case hardened. Alloy steel case hardened has got a allowable static stress value which is closest to this 351.2, which is 345. Therefore, we assume that the gear is made up of alloy steel case hardened with allowable static stress of 345. Alright, so summarizing what you have done so far is, we have identified the pitch circle diameters, we have identified the number of teeth, and then we identify the Lewis form factor, and then identify the materials too. Okay, so now we are in a position to identify which is the weaker member among pinion and gear, which we will see in the next slide. Okay, so to identify the weaker member, we follow the same approach that we obtain the product of sigma d into y, that is static stress into Lewis form factor for both pinion and gear, and the smaller value among both, that is in this case it's 49.197, which is for gear, would mean that gear is the weaker member. So with that, we have identified the weaker member, and then we proceed to obtain the module. Now to calculate module, we know that we need to obtain the tangential tooth load. All right. Now tangential tooth load can be obtained using two equations, that is both power equation as well as Lewis equation. So we will use the tangential tooth load using power equation first. Now, this is the power equation which we get from the handbook. Now here you see that the tangential tooth load value is obtained by already multiplying by CS, okay, which is service factor. Now we calculate the velocity, linear velocity first, FIDN by 60,000 and you end up with 3.35 meters per second, which is linear velocity of the gear. Then further to solve this equation, you need CS, service factor, and we know that from table 12.8, we need to assume the operation like environment, and by assuming light shocks and 24 hours per day service severity, we get CS as equal to 1.5. Now substitute it back into the power equation and you will obtain the tangential tooth load of the gear as 8057.22 Newton. Okay. So you have obtained tangential tooth load using power equation. Okay. Now to determine module, what we do is tangential tooth load is also expressed by Lewis equation, equation 12.5a, as in this form. We will take Lewis equation in this form to obtain a module. Now here, face width we know is b is between 9.5 module to 12.5 module, and we normally select 10 module. And circular pitch we know is equal to pi times module. So substitute it into the Lewis equation and you get a formula of this nature, equation number 4. Alright, so now what we do is, velocity we already know. Okay. So knowing velocity, it is possible for me to solve for the velocity factor Cv. Right, for v equal to 3.35 meters per second, from data handbook, Barth equation up to 8 meters per second, we obtain a velocity factor as 0.4766. So you can see in equation number 4 now, we already know tangential tooth load as 8057.22. Velocity factor also we know. So if you substitute these two, we can solve for module M, which we will do in the next slide. Alright, so let's solve for module now. Okay, by like equating 3 and 4, we can solve for module and we get it as 3.3 mm. Now, from table 12.2, we can see that the nearest first preference value is 4. Therefore, in this problem, module M is equal to 4. Alright, so now going forward, we need to check for the stresses. We need to check if the choice of module is proper or not. So checking for stress, initially what we do is we will check for allowable and induced stress. The allowable stress we know is allowable static stress multiplied by the velocity factor. Alright, so by doing that we get allowable stress as 164.421. Induced stress we know is obtained from the Lewis equation. Rearranging the Lewis equation, we get the induced stress value. Substitute that, you know all the factors now, B, Y and P, substitute that, and induced stress comes to 112.41. Now we see that induced stress is smaller than the allowable stress, therefore the design is safe. This is for induced stress. Now let's also check for beam strength. Beam strength, by beam strength we mean it is the maximum stress which the gear tooth can withstand without bending failure. Alright, now to we have seen in the previous problem also that to calculate beam strength we need to take effective force. That is, effective force is nothing but the tangential tooth load which we have already obtained divided by Cv multiplied by Cs. Now Cs we have already multiplied it in our power equation. So we divide by Cv only. Therefore, effective force is tangential tooth load of the gear divided by Cv, and we get 16,905.62 Newton. Alright. Now, so substituting this back into the beam strength equation, that is your Lewis equation, the beam strength will now be you can actually solve it as 24,729.10 Newton. Therefore, we have both effective force as well as beam strength. Beam strength is the maximum load that can be applied, and effective load is the load that is induced in this problem. So factor of safety will be the ratio of maximum by induced, that is beam strength by effective force, and we get a value of 1.46, which is greater than 1, therefore the design is safe. Alright, so we have checked for induced stress and we have checked for a beam strength. Next we need to check for dynamic load and then wear load, and then arrive at the Brinell hardness number as usual, alright, which we will see in the next slide. Alright, so let's look into dynamic load now. Dynamic load we calculate using Buckingham formula, that is equation 12.12. Alright, now you know all the factors there except for the dynamic factor C. But we have seen before that to find the dynamic factor, we first obtain 0.0 the gear error E, that is assuming a specific gear application. In this problem, I have assumed the gear to be of class 3, precision gears. It's an assumption which you can make. We get the value of error E as 0.0127, and for this value of error, from table 12.12, page number 236, for steel and steel, that is for both pinion and gear made up of steel, and for 20 degree full depth, we see that the dynamic factor error lies between 0.01 and 0.02. Alright, so you need to interpolate for error equal to 0.0127. Okay, so you interpolate it and you obtain the dynamic factor as 145.32. Okay, now substituting everything back into the Buckingham's formula, we get a dynamic force as 13,192.74 newton. Right, so the dynamic force we have obtained now. Now if you see, the dynamic factor is greater than the tangential tooth load. Okay, so that is the observation that we typically make. Now we use this dynamic load and then determine the wear load also, which we will see in the next slide. Okay, now to determine the wear load and to obtain the Brinell hardness number, as usual, the wear load equation we get from 12.15A as D1BQK. We need to solve for K. Once we know K, we will get the hardness numbers. Okay, now to solve for K, we know that the ratio factor Q is obtained from equation 12.15C, and in this problem it comes to 1.6. Now by equating wear load to the dynamic load, we can solve for K, and K ends up being 3.222. Alright, now from table 12.16, for both material being steel and pressure angle of 20 degrees, the value of K closest to the obtained value of 3.222 is 3.226. Therefore, for K equal to 3.226 in table 12.16, we see that the Brinell hardness number for gear and pinion both are 450. You need to have a Brinell hardness number of 450 for safe design. Okay, so this is the Brinell hardness number. Now we have the last step where we get the gear tooth parameters for a module MEK, M is equal to 4, which we will see in the next slide. Okay, so moving on, from table 12.4A, you can calculate all the gear tooth characteristics or the gear tooth dimensions. These formulas that you see are obtained in your handbook. Now, since we know that module is equal to 4, substituting M is equal to 4, you get all the other gear tooth dimensions here. Alright, so that finishes off the design problem. Now, what I would like to tell you is that design of gear problems are usually open-ended, in the sense the results that you get are dependent upon the assumptions that you make. So there will not be one typical answer for any problem that we solve in design of guess, unless we make the same assumptions, that is. Okay. So, but you need to know the design process. You need to know which like equations and which tabular column to choose. So I suggest that you pick up problems on your own and start solving it. Okay. The design process is more procedural, and it is picking up the right formula, right table, and solving. All right. Okay. Now before we go, I would also state that I will have uploaded three problems, three solved problems. There are two more problems which I will not be preparing a PPT, but which are there in my notes, and I will upload the scanned version of my notes for problem number 4 and 5. Alright, please go through it on your own. It is self-explanatory. If you have seen these three videos, you will be able to follow those two problems as well. Okay, and I will follow it up with as usual, like assignments and quiz. Alright, thank you.